I don't have to tell you, but it's been quite the year. Just like you, I haven't been able to stop doom scrolling through the news. We've had the pandemic, civil unrest, the election, and now wildfires. Yeah, a bunch of those.
Autumn traditionally kicks off California's peak fire season, but a historic number of fires have already blazed through the state.
Out here in Northern California, where I live, I remember one morning I woke up, the fires were so intense that the sky was like a weird orange color. I tweeted a picture of Blade Runner 2049 when it looked kind of the same, and people couldn't even tell the difference. People were pissed at me all day. Where in Oakland is this? I've never seen this statue before in my life. And I didn't respond to anybody because I thought it was kind of funny. But it was also really, really scary that you couldn't tell the difference. Now, while this tough season might be over, we're not completely off the hook because there's still next year where there'll definitely be more fires. It's not like climate change is going anywhere anytime soon. Now, one thing I've been hearing a lot about in the news lately are these things called good fires. Now, that's referring to controlled or a prescribed burn where we deliberately set fires to help prevent future ones. Traditionally, indigenous people held controlled burns for many cultural reasons and to keep wildfires from running amok. But then in the early 20th century, for whatever reason, I don't know, but we stopped listening to the indigenous people, and that gets us to where we are today. Should we set more good fires to help fight bad ones? We hit a pretty grim milestone recently. If a fire burns more than 100,000 acres, that's a megafire. This past summer, the August Complex fire that hit north of here was caused by a series of lightning strikes. It scorched more than 1 million acres. That's bigger than the entire Yosemite National Park. It's our state's first gigafire and the largest in California's history. And it's not just here. Earlier this year, Australia also had a massive gigafire when they battled its largest bushfire to date that incinerated over 1.5 million acres. NASA said the smoke produced by that inferno traveled at least one full circuit around the globe, which creates serious health risks both locally and all around the world. To get more perspective on wildfires, I reached out to Danielle Vinton, a science reporter for KQED Science. She covers this topic a lot, and she also lives in Sonoma County, an area that's been historically hit hard by them.
Can you talk about how fire season has become much worse or worse due to climate change?
We know climate change has made certain areas, especially of the West and California, hotter and drier. That also dries out vegetation. As climate change gets worse, it expands the fire season. There's also more stuff to burn because we've suppressed fires for so long. Out of control, catastrophic wildfires that are really damaging for a forest create an incredible amount of pollution. They put out enormous amount of carbon dioxide and greenhouse gases into the atmosphere, and that makes climate change even worse. So there's a destructive feedback cycle. Good fires can replenish the forest and make it more capable of sequestering more carbon. So that is an additional benefit. A very important aspect of adapting to fire is reducing the amount of built-up vegetation. The safest way is to do it by hand, with hand tools and crews who literally clear out brush and debris. But that's also the most labor-intensive and expensive, and it's not feasible that we will be able to treat all of California like that. So prescribed fire is really the least expensive, best tool that we have to reducing vegetation.
But prescribed fires take a lot of work. Like Goldilocks and the Three Bears, the conditions have to be just right. Land managers refer to the timing as a burn window. It's open or shut, depending on the current situation. If it's too hot and dry, it'll be harder and more expensive to manage a prescribed burn as more people and resources are needed to keep it from going out of control. You also have to monitor the wind and how much water is in the soil. If the ground is too wet from rain, well, you can't have a fire. And before anything's lit, forest managers have to do some housekeeping and thin the buildup of brush and trees first. Yet setting fire still just doesn't sit well with a lot of people, especially since many of us love nature, and we think fires destroy forest life rather than regenerate it.
Once there was a little boy who liked to visit his friends, the trees.
Hello, tree.
Hello, boy.
I think it's really useful to think about good fire and to think about bad fire. What bad fire looks like, we kind of know. It burns way up high in the canopy and can kill trees and can also kill the organisms in the soil. Bad fire easily gets into neighborhoods and can destroy whole towns like we've seen. Good fire, on the other hand, burns close to the ground, doesn't go high up in the trees, it doesn't destroy animals, they have time to move away, and it improves soil health. It can regenerate new growth. Some trees need it to sprout new seedlings. And that good fire is manageable. You can kind of decide when you want to put it out. But concerns about clean air have been a barrier in the past to getting more prescribed fire on land. We have regulators in this state who want to keep the air clear. And that at times has made it difficult for people to set prescribed fires, because you have to get a lot of permits, you have to go through a lot of paperwork. And some people get upset when there's smoke in the air, they know it's intentional. Something that is important to know though, that the pollution from out of control wildfires is much more toxic. Prescribed fires are usually burning only vegetation, and they're burning in a less intense way than wildfires, which may torch a whole neighborhood.
You know, like we said earlier, you live in Sonoma County, you know what I'm saying? I'm here in Oakland. So it's like, what changes do you think should happen, like on a local level, kind of, you know, or do you think people should just, I've heard people like, just move, just leave. And it's like, how am I gonna leave my home or where am I supposed to go? So it's like, yeah, what do you think needs to happen in that regard?
I mean, I think in places like Sonoma County that are really prone to fires, there is a lot we can do to be more safe. And that comes from prescribed fires, building fire breaks, planning better for evacuation routes, hardening homes so that they're less flammable. I also think there's room to talk about whether there are some areas that are just too dangerous to build or to rebuild. I love living here, grew up here. There are parts of this county where I would not move to because I would be too scared. That's a very controversial idea. People do not like to be told that they can't rebuild or that it feels like the property rights are being taken away. If we're going to adapt to climate-driven fires, we need to be comfortable having that conversation at least.
So I know I've got a lot to think about, but let's take a step back. Regardless of whether you live here in California or not, climate change is gonna climate change. So whether you want your skies to also one day probably be orange like some sci-fi movie stuff, then maybe we should do something about it. But I wanna hear from you. Should we fight fire with fire? Let us know in the comments below. As always, I'm your host, Miles Best. Till next time, peace out.